Welcome everyone to Peri Ortho Institute. I'm Mariana Evans. Today we are going to talk about transverse diagnosis and maxillary expansion in honor of Slek van Aarsdel. Dr. van Aarsdel made a significant contribution into the field of orthodontics and dentistry in general when it comes to management of maxillary deficiency, addressing transverse skeletal problems, management of impacted canines, treatment of periodontally compromised patients with orthodontic appliances. He will always be remembered, and he played a very critical role in my education at Penn. We are going to discuss today the importance of transverse diagnosis, periodontal rationale for maxillary expansion, evolution of expansion devices, and surgically assisted protocol, the past and the future. We have a very special guest tonight, Dr. Miguel Hirschhaut from Venezuela, who is also a graduate of Penn Ortho and a student of Dr. van Aarsdel. Welcome, Dr. Miguel, and thank you so much for being with us tonight. We had the opportunity to meet in person a few years ago in Philadelphia at one of our TED expansion courses. I have been following Dr. Miguel for years on Facebook, fascinated by his cases, his surgical cases, his photography, documentation, and we are very, very honored to have you today. So welcome, Dr. Miguel Hirschhaut.
Thank you very much, Mariana, for the invitation, and I'm gonna present what I think it's like relevant stuff. And as you said, I was fortunate to take your course. I was in a trip that I went to Penn. I gave a lecture to the grad students, and then I spent 2 days with you, and you really treated me very well. And you taught me a lot. You were the first TAD expansion course that I took, and I became very fond of this, and I always thank you because you were very generous with your knowledge. So it all starts with a Slek idea of the transverse as the basis for sagittal and vertical correction. He always stressed that out. He said that you need to set up the transverse first, and then you can correct the vertical and you can correct the sagittal. And he has this paper in seminars, and he was a big believer in what the early work of Dr. Robert Ricketts. Actually, Slek followed his stuff, and actually Ricketts was the first one to really take into account the transverse dimension. Before him, if you look at the cephalometrics, they were only sagittal or AP. So Ricketts was the first one to take into account the maxillary width, mandibular width, the norms for each age. He also looked at surgical cases back in the 60s with the PASF, and he was one of the first ones to look at the TMJ tomograms. So Dr. van Aarsdel pretty much took a lot of stuff from Dr. Ricketts, and this PASF analysis was the way we used to measure it when I was in the program to assess if the maxilla was efficient. After that, of course, came the paper from Tamburino and Non-Boucher and Dr. van Aarsdel and Antonino, and they start measuring with the CTCB, which is maxilla minus mandible. It should be 5, but you can still measure it on the PASF. And it all comes down to Dr. van Aarsdel's concern of not producing long-term periodontal effects that you're going to talk more into detail, since you are an orthodontist and a periodontist. I'm just an orthodontist. I finished in 95, and I think you finished in 2010. So I've been 15 more years in private practice, but you have the dual specialty, so you have much more knowledge on many things. But I always remember that Dr. van Aarsdel said that his main concern was when you try to dentally tip the teeth out, you get fenestrations and dehiscences, and you get long-term periodontal problems. And that's why he always, even with the initial expanders that were tooth-borne, he preferred the Haas or the occlusal coverage on the regular expanders because he didn't want to have vocal side effects on the vocal cortical plate. But even looking at this paper, you can see that on the best case scenario with one of these acrylic expanders that I call them the pen expanders, you only get 65% change in the bone. So sometimes that's why we need two or even three expanders in some of these patients. So I took this picture, the first three pictures are from a book on MARPE, and then the other two, I just took them from the internet. There are many expanders that you can use. Momertz probably in 1999 starting using like a transpalatal screw, and then you people at Penn, I think you started using them with John Kakovian in the lab in 2008. Then Benedict Wilms came with his expander. It's an expander that it's, uses more the anterior portion of the palate, on the third rugae. Then Dr. Moon came with his expander. And then Juan Carlos Perez Varela came with an expander that it's more just bone-borne. So he cuts the arms and he doesn't have the extension arms, the soft arms that the MSC2 uses. So it's an evolution of the devices. And I think every device has an advantage and a disadvantage. I don't think what's good, it's what works well in your hands. Of course, I think eventually everything will move to just bone-borne. And there are many papers lately on the angle and comparing bone-borne with hybrid expanders. And when I talked with Dr. Moon, I interviewed Dr. Moon and I asked him about the arms on the expander on the MSC2, if the molars were tipped out. He said that's contrarrested because the arms are soft arms. They're not like rigid arms. So everybody's thinking about, in a way, about periodontal implications, tipping. Even actually, if you tip the molars, what happens with the cusp if they're hanging and they cause interference on the, or they may cause some TMJ alteration. So this is the first expander, the most simple one, and I think the most cost efficient. I love it. I use it a lot. I think it's very good for teenagers. And the one concept that really Dr. Van Arsdell stressed was the vocal corridors and the negative space. He was always concerned about that. So when we look at our adolescent patient, this is a 17-year-old male. We want to make sure that with this expander, it's a lateral wall expander. It's not a bicortical paramedial expander like the Moon. It's just a lateral wall expander. It uses four screws and has an acrylic pad. We want to make sure that we truly get the full feel of the corridors. This patient had a posterior crossbite. I expand mainly on patients that have maxillary deficiency and posterior crossbites. As we've discussed before, I talked with you. I still have some of my concerns with airways, and I would like to see more dynamic studies rather than static studies. And I've talked about this with Dr. Moon and with Juan Carlos Perez Varela and with many people. But in any case, you can make the maxilla wide, and you compare always the initial CBCT with the post-expansion CBCT, and you get to measure the change. Of course, this expander, in my hands at least, produces more of a V expansion, not as a parallel expansion as we get with the Moon MSC. I only use two expanders in my office. I use the Penec expander, and then I use the MSC. But you get these large diastemas, and of course you get to change the arch form. I only use with the four screws. I don't use with two screws. I know some people try them with two screws. But then you can see that once the patient is treated that you get the crossbite corrected, you get a full broad smile. And of course this patient is still chin deficiency, so he's gonna go to Nelson Leon, our oral maxillofacial surgeon that you know well, because you did the RNET course together. He's gonna get an advanced meningioplasty for this kid. But this is interesting, just to look at the transverse, the negative space and the vocal corridors, which was one of the big things Dr. Van Arsdell stressed. Then if you look at the maxilla, And I like to superimpose the picture with the CBCT, and you get to see that you actually really changing the skeletal base for these patients. This is another girl. I'm not gonna go into diagnosis details or CBCT or stuff because I know you wanna do it. So I just wanna show a few cases and tell you my opinion and my concerns. This is a girl that you can see that she has a posterior crossbite, a very narrow maxilla. She was 10 millimeters deficient, actually almost 10 millimeters deficient. You can see the vocal segments in the lower posteriors are totally leaning in. She was very narrow. So again, we place some touch, we place the expander, and we made her wider. But we're making her wider to correct her crossbite. And also at the same time, we can align that blocked out cuspid. We're changing her arch form. But you can still see that the expansion has a V shape with a base in the anterior portion and an apex in the posterior portion. And even if you look at from the frontal view, you still see a base in the anterior portion, then you see an apex towards the nose. And then you get just to move the teeth and move them everywhere, just sliding. But then again, you can compare the initial CVCT with the post-expansion CVCT. And then what I did for her is since the vocal segments were also leaning forward, we placed some vocal shelf tabs, as we learned from Dr. Chang. We started uprighting everything, and you can see the before and the progress. And now we just have to place a little infrazygomatic tab in the upper left segment just to get a better class one cuspid in that side, and we're done. Actually, what I do is I remove the vocal shelf on the lower right side, and I will change it to the upper left side. And then this concept that Slick always like to talk about, you can see that her vocal corridors were filled and her negative space was corrected. As I told you before, I don't see expansion for crowding solution, and I know we have different views in that. I think expansion is for transverse correction, but also in a case like this, once you make the apical base wider, you get to fix the crowding. Also, I don't think that, in my view at least, I don't think we're out of the woods with extractions. I think we still need to extract these in some cases, not in this one, but in some cases. As I told you, my belief is that the lower arch has a fixed distance between the last molar and the ramus, and you don't have a midline suture unless you do distraction osteogenesis in the mandible, which has limited indications. We've done a few surgical distractions just in the mandible, but it's very rare. So I still think there is a place for extractions in orthodontics. This is a change in the CVCT before and after, superimposed with a picture. Then I wanted to make a few comments on the Moon device. And then at the end, I'm gonna make a few comments on how we do the SARPE and the modifications that we have incorporated to make them minimally invasive. I like to do drawings to show the students. Actually, we started first with the MSC1, which was with the key. It was a little bit flimsy, and then we changed to the MSC2. This is a male, he's 22 years old. So I think for young males, it works fine. Once they go over the age of 25 to 30, I'm more concerned with it. And in my opinion, it's better to do a SARPE, like a minimally invasive SARPE, with the technique developed by Federico Hernandez Alfaro, and I will show you the cuts, how we make them with Nelson. As I discussed with you as well before, I don't believe much in, or at least in my experience, in my hands, cortipunctures are not as useful. So if they don't split, we go directly to the corticotomies. Because I think if you think of it from the logic point of view, the midline suture is not the main resistance to expansion. It's the circummaxillary suture. So that's why I have a little problem with the concept of the cortipuncture. And then you get to see how we split them. This graphic is interesting. I'll show it to you. I got it from Dr. Daniela Garit from Brazil. And it talks about actually the zone where you are allowed to and you're not supposed to place palatal tats. And I think we have to be careful. Of course, Ludwig and Benedict have published on this also as well with the T zone. But it's important to keep in mind that you have to be careful with the artery, especially for lateral wall expanders. I think for the paramedial bicortical expander by Moon, you don't have the problem because in the middle you see you don't have any vasos or nothing. This is a 25-year-old female with a posterior crossbite. We're doing the MSC2. And you can see how we, after 20 turns, 30 turns, 42 turns, then 52 turns, so we got her to split. And I brought this case because it's interesting. She was very deficient as well. She had a 10 millimeter deficiency. So I used a 10 millimeter Marpe Moon. I couldn't fit a 12 one. But after I expanded her, I asked a few people, actually, I think even I consulted you, and I decided to place then a Hyrax, just a Hyrax, because the suture was open, and I ended up getting the difference that I needed just with the Hyrax. So green is pre-expansion, and then purple is post Marpe, and then a Hyrax just to complement it. And you can see that, we've talked about this also, you can see that A point comes forward a little bit. Of course, not as much as if you were pulling it with a reverse pull headgear like Dr. Moon does or like you do. But if you look at the classic literature, Wertz and Andy Haas and all of them, they even mentioned that A point comes a little bit forward with expansion. And it's interesting, we get to see it even in the Marpe cases. Then I brought you a few slides to comment on Sarpe, on the conventional technique and on the technique we're using now. I've done many surgical assisted rapid palatal expanders since 1995. The slide on the left is the classical cut, the Lefort one, that we did with Dr. Jorge Ravelo. It's a full liberation. Then on the right side is a modification of the osteotomy we did with Nelson León. A little cut between the central and the canine because the patient was missing the lateral. So just to place the split where we needed the space. But this is just the regular technique. It's just a down fracture of the maxilla. This is the same way we learn at Penn, and we follow the Banars-Albets protocol, which is 8 turns at surgery, then wait for 1 week, and then do 1 turn in the morning, 1 turn at night until you're done. But if you look at the slide on the right, this is what we're doing with Nelson now, is the minimally invasive surgery of the minimally invasive Sarpe. It's a technique developed by Federico Hernandez Alfaro from Barcelona. And the cuts are, of course, minimally invasive. He just does a midline cut. This is the paper. This is the midline cut we do with Nelson. And then I'll get back to the paper so you can do a screenshot. And then we do just the posterior cuts on the pterygoid because you need to liberate the posterior portion. As I told you before, we don't believe that the main resistance to expansion is in the midline, even though we do the full cut of the midline, but we still need to do the posterior cut. So this paper is very nice if people want to take a screenshot. Actually, I think Dr. Hernandez Alfaro was ready to publish the 500 cases. This first paper was on 283 cases. Yeah, it's a modification of the Sarpe. It's done in the office. It's done in 15 minutes. It's done with sedation, just like an endoscopy. You don't need to go to the OR. It's a midline cut, and then it's two posterior cuts. So I think this paper is interesting to review. This is one of my old cases. I did this case 26 years ago. It also shows a nice concept that Dr. Van Arsdale stressed out, which is when you have large discrepancies, you need to split them. Means that you need to expand first, correct the transverse, and then you can correct the sagittal and the vertical. So this patient was very narrow. in the maxilla, so we decided just to make him wider in the maxilla. He also had a mandibular asymmetry. So we staged him in two procedures. First procedure, we did for him a surgical assisted rapid palatal expansion with the removal of 4 wisdom teeth. And that lesion on the lower left side was an ameloblastoma. So on the first surgery, surgical assisted rapid palatal expansion, removal of 4 wisdom teeth, and we decompensate the case. We set him up. Back in the old days, we used to take occlusal x-rays. Now we can see it with the CBCT. We don't need to take the occlusal x-rays. As you see, I did them with my Hyrax expanders, not with the Haas expander, which would have been what Dr. Barnarza would have liked. We still get this, which is the patch of Atherton, which is a tissue that matures. The teeth move faster than the maturation of the tissue. So this was described by Atherton in other types of movement, but Dr. Van Arsdale used to talk about it with the sarpent. And then we just set him up, and in the second surgical procedure, he got the symmetric mandibular setback, the maxillary advancement. Back in the old days, those laterals that were small, they were bonded. Today, probably they would have been, they would have gotten some other kind of material, probably porcelain veneers or something. This is another girl, you asked me to show you this one, where we did a surgical assisted expansion with advancement. We did it like in a surgery first mode. So she just got the braces on and the expansion and the advancement. I did this with Jorge Ravelo. Then after the expansion and the advancement was done, we took out upper premolars and we just brought the upper incisors that were very flare forward back. So this is just 15 months into treatment. You can see in 15 months, the amount of change we get. She still has a broad smile, but I think her amount of crowning in the upper arch required, besides the sarpe and the advancement, required the extraction of 2 premolars just to get better angulations of these incisors. These are classical expansion case, another one we did many years ago. I show this because it's interesting and it's important that you need to decompensate the lower arch first. You wanna have the lower arch set and then do the expansion. In this case, I changed the sequence a little bit, but it's a difference between sarpe and conventional expansion. In just say conventional expansion without TATS, you overexpand 40% in sarpe, you don't overexpand. So you need to have your vocal segments uprighted. And these are just the changes you get in the upper arch form. And this is the paper that Dr. Van Arsdale and Norm Bates did back, I think, in the 95 in the International Journal. And it has all the protocol of the expansion.
Thank you, Dr. Hirschhout, for outstanding presentation today. And I will continue on transverse diagnosis and maxillary expansion in honor of Dr. Slek Van Arsdale. Dr. Van Arsdale played a very critical role in my education. He inspired me to perceive a specialty of orthodontics and periodontics. He was my mentor, my program director, my chair. And it was very special to learn from him and also to learn from his mentor, Dr. Morten Amsterdam. It was extremely special to see both of them interact. Their love, their respect for each other was very, very special. So let's talk about transverse discrepancies. Dr. Van Arsdale always taught us that transverse problems are going to be a problem for periodontal health of the patient, for longevity of the orthodontic results, and also for stability of the occlusion. And ideally, we want the teeth positioned axially in the bone to receive axial loading. So in order for us to achieve this relationship, maxillary dimension has to fit in a certain way with the mandible. How much to expand maxilla? I think it's a very important question, and unfortunately today we do not have a consensus in orthodontic community. You can have one patient presented to 5-10 different orthodontists, and each of them will probably expand, even if they choose to, expand each patient the different amount. Evaluation of the transverse discrepancies has significantly evolved from measuring the problem at the level of the teeth. And we know that there is a problem measuring at the level of the teeth because of the dental alveolar compensation. It's not accurate when the patient is lacking posterior crossbite and the maxillary teeth are buccally tipped. To measuring the problem at the level of the bone, because it is a bone problem. So we have evolved from measuring the teeth to measuring the bone at the level of the maxillary basal dimension, mandibular basal dimension from PA-TACS before we had 3D imaging available to us. And today, luckily, we have CBCT technology that allows for a little bit more accurate diagnosis. Dr. Van Arsdale was a very strong proponent of the Ricketts analysis to measure transverse discrepancies because that's the best we had at the time. And of course, it's not the most accurate way to measure the problem, but it was more accurate than measuring the dentition. And of course, even with multiple studies suggesting that CBCT technology is superior in evaluating transverse discrepancies, validation CBCT studies are still pending. So as of today, we have some data available to us where we can measure maxillary and mandibular dimension on the inner side of the maxilla and the mandible, on the lingual side, at the level of the molars, and this was reported in the minor study, and the inner differential from that study was ranging from -1 to 2.9, and the study from University of Pennsylvania by Dr. Michael Simontacci from 2010, unfortunately, is not published today, but found that in physiologically normal occlusal relationship, the outer differential, which is measured as a difference between MX width to the width at the mandible at the level of the mucogingival junction, which is actually a combination of Ricketts and Andrews analysis, where the maxillary measurement is taken from the Ricketts and the mandibular measurement is taken from the Andrews analysis. So the outer differential based on that study is averaging 5 millimeters. So in other words, the maxilla at the MX should be 5 millimeters wider than the mandible at the level of the mucogingival junction. So let's look at the first case that I would like to share with you today. And this is the patient with no crossbite between the maxillary and mandibular posterior teeth, no crossbite in the front. When you look at the maxilla, you can probably fit all of the maxillary teeth without a problem, without any extraction or expansion. There is spacing between anterior teeth, sufficient space for the canine eruption on the left. And in the mandible, however, you have a pronounced curve of spare. There's very minimal crowding. So we know once we level that curve, that we will need some intra-arch space in the mandible and in the maxilla to allow for good overbite without the frammatus in the anterior teeth. Many of these patients with this type of malocclusion will be treated today without expansion, with fixed appliances, with orthodontic aligners. The spaces will be closed, but will this patient present with orthodontic stability long-term? I find that if you finish a case with very tight occlusion between the maxillary and mandibular anterior teeth, you will often have unstable result where a patient may present with reopening of diastema or increased mobility in the maxillary anterior teeth and some periodontal problems. So when you look at the facial appearance of this patient, you can appreciate that she has bimaxillary retrusion and a significant expression of the facial musculature on smile. So when you go back to the clinical intraoral photograph, you ask yourself a question: do we want to expand or do we not want to expand this patient? Can we treat this patient without expansion? And if we are going to expand, how much are we going to expand this patient? So when you look at the outer and inner differential, based on the CBCT imaging, you can see that although clinically this patient does not have any posterior crossbite, the outer differential has 2.6 millimeter deficiency and the inner differential has a deficiency of 3 to 4 millimeters based on the reported norms. And the problem becomes, what are you going to follow? Are you going to expand this patient based on the inner differential, based on the outer differential? Again, we need validation studies. We don't have the data yet, and I don't have the answer for you. So when you look at the clinical picture, let's say you don't have a CBCT and this particular patient does not have any posterior crowding, what you see clinically is just the relationship between the crowns of the maxillary and mandibular teeth. What you don't see is the root position of these teeth in the bone. Periodontally speaking, it's very critical for the roots of the maxillary and mandibular teeth to be a certain distance between each other to allow for sufficient blood supply and bone support to the roots. If the roots are too close together, these patients are going to have a problem. And we know that. And this is what Slick was preaching when he was lecturing and publishing. So today we have a technology where we can do 3D simulation of the ideal positioning of the teeth axially, maxillary teeth in relationship to mandibular teeth. So once we did that 3D dental simulation, we can project it on the bone and we can see that the patient has significant dehiscences and fenestration on the simulation in the anterior portion of the maxilla and partially even at the level of the molars. So dental bowel expansion may clinically not present with periodontal problems immediately after orthodontic treatment, but over time, those dehiscences and fenestrations may transform into gingival recession and mucogingival problems in adults. And I have treated enough adult patients with gingival recession where the first problem was not skeletally addressed. And this is what Slick was committed to teach, to share how important it is to expand the maxilla for periodontal reasons. So now you can also do a skeletal stimulation of the maxillary expansion. And you can see when we expand maxilla at the level of the midpalatal suture, we can achieve very similar inclination of the dentition. And in the same time, those teeth are not positioned outside the bone. So skeletal expansion allows us to achieve better axial inclination of the teeth without taking the teeth outside the bone and compromising them periodontally. So based on that simulation, this patient of mine will benefit from 4 millimeters of skeletal expansion to improve that axial inclination of the maxillary dentition and to allow for sufficient interproximal spacing between the roots of the maxillary teeth. So now you see finished result, you see nicely aligned dentition, nice periodontal support around these teeth. And when you project on the CBCT, you can see that the roots are safely approximated to allow sufficient blood supply and proximal bone support to those maxillary teeth and also axially positioned to achieve axial loading. So here you have a simulation in the middle, pre-treatment position of the teeth and post-treatment position of the teeth, and you can appreciate how closely we were able to achieve positioning of the teeth after treatment to simulation. And believe it or not, alignment of these teeth was not achieved through indirect bonding with the 3D guided bracket positioning on the teeth. It was achieved basically just on expansion and positioning of the brackets in the right position in the crown. When you look at the outer differential, we achieved 2.5 millimeters of expansion, and we did have approximately 2.5 need of the efficiency when we look at the outer differential. So we ended up having 5 millimeter outer differential, which is considered a norm. And when you look at the inner differential, we achieved 4 millimeters of expansion, and the inner differential had a 3 to 4 millimeter of deficiency, so we addressed it, and now maxillary and mandibular widths are 1 to 1. When you look at the outer and inner differential, it's the same patient, but we achieved different amount of expansion at the level of the palate versus at the level of a max point, and this has to do with the bending of the maxillary facial segments as a result of the skeletal expansion, because this patient underwent implant-assisted expansion. And when you look at the cross-sections at the level of the first premolars, and remember, tooth number 12 looks a little bit periodontally compromised prior to orthodontic intervention. Now we position the tooth in a better dental alveolar housing, and the buccal plate is thicker and is going to protect the tooth for life. So we position the tooth in a better occlusal relationship with mandibular dentition and also in the bone to achieve axial loading. And of course, that muscle pull may have to be addressed in the future. But right now, it does not cause any blanching in the pre-gingival margins. So this is something that we will monitor. And this is the facial outcome. So you can see that there are significant improvements in the facial aesthetics, in the smile aesthetics. You have an eye-opening effect from mid-facial expansion that we will discuss the mechanism in a few minutes. You have a fill of the buccal corridors. This is what Slick was always talking about, that you have improvement in the smile aesthetics from the skeletal expansion. You have nicely axially uprighted maxillary teeth. You don't have maxillary teeth that are flat, which is very commonly found from dental alveolar expansion when maxilla is too narrow or too deficient. And you have a nice cheekbone projection. So when you look overall at the smile after treatment, the smile architecture looks more relaxed. The patient's face is more relaxed, more balanced as compared to a pre-treatment facial smile. So the whole face is smiling before expansion, and just lower third of the face is smiling as it should be after expansion. So let's look at another case, because not every case is going to be so perfect where we can diagnose that transverse problem from the CBCT alone. Yes, there are going to be cases outside the box that you have to apply other principles to determine how much to expand and if you need to expand at all. So here is a 12-year-old pre-menarche female that presented to me for orthodontic second opinion in search of alternative treatment options to extraction and orthodontic surgery. So you can see that she had mid-facial deficiency, a class 3 tendency. And when you look at the intraoral photograph, she presents with significant mandibular crowding, anterior crossbite, no posterior crossbite, and blocked out maxillary canine on the right side. When you look at the 3D model again, you can see that the maxillary anterior and posterior teeth are flat buccally. When you look at the lateral sac, it's severe skeletal class 3 problem with horizontal mandibular growth and upright lower incisors. So imagine if you start uprighting, leveling those lower incisors without extraction, you're going to proclime them. That's the general thinking in the orthodontic community when you have severe crowding, and that's what we find from many studies as well. When you look at the transverse evaluation at the level of the molars, so the left image is the cross-section at the level of the maxillary first molar, but because of the class 3 on that image, the mandibular teeth are actually not first molars, are second molars. So we took a cross section through the first molar, which is the central image on the slide. And you can see that the outer differential has no transverse issue. It has, it's 7 and the normal is 5. So maxilla is actually 2 millimeters wider than is suggested to be normal. And the inner differential is between 4 to 7, depends where you're going to measure, and the norm is minus 1 to plus 3. So even the inner differential doesn't show any transverse discrepancies. So the question becomes, are you going to treat this problem in the transverse dimension, or are you going not to expand? So based on that transverse CBCT analysis, this patient doesn't need expansion. Ideally, when you see this problem, traditionally, we would treat a case like that with extractions. And Miguel showed today a very similar case where he still expanded maxilla, and I would still expand maxilla just to improve axial intonation of the maxillary teeth and fit that right canine passively into the center of the ridge. But ideally, to address that plus three malocclusion, because of that severe mandibular crowding, you probably will have to extract upper fours, lower fives, and do maxillary advancement. And the reason why you need to extract teeth, because you want to decompensate. But the patient is against surgery. The patient says, I'm not going to have surgery, and I don't want to extract any teeth. Are there any alternative options? So for patients like that, you have to look at other parameters. So here you have a medical history of significant airway problems. So patient has history of chronic allergies, seasonal allergies, allergy to cats, sinusitis with chronic headaches, chronic nasal congestion, chronic postnasal drip with coughing, snoring, and poor sleep quality. So look at the CBCT in the sagittal slice. Look at the adenoidal tissue. Look at the coronal slice at the severe nasal obstruction, inflammation of the nasal and sinus mucosa. So we decided to expand this patient. And again, the outer differential was normal. The inner differential did not indicate the need for expansion. When you look at the pre-treatment simulation of the orthodontic alignment of the maxillary dentition, you can appreciate that again, once you apply those maxillary teeth, you need more room, not only for the crowns, but you need more room for the roots. Otherwise, those roots are going to be outside the bone. So this simulation is very helpful. So because we need more room for the roots, we expanded this patient. Because of the age of the patient, we use the TAD-assisted expansion protocol that we will discuss in a few minutes. And here on the right slide, you can see that the after expansion was completed. We locked the bands on the upper first premolars to the expander. And those bands are molar bands with hooks to allow maxillary protraction with indirect implant-assisted anchorage. You also see that there are coils distal to the central incisors. This was Slick's idea. I remember him teaching us, saying, remember that after expansion, you don't want to dump those upper incisors with A-chains. It's very easy to close diastema with A-chains, but those incisors will retract. And it's very critical for class 3 patients to keep those incisors in the proper inclination to not make class 3 more pronounced. So remember, he was teaching us doing advancement of those maxillary incisors one by one, 1-to-1, then 2-to-2, with distalizing coils behind them, the laterals, one of the centrals closed, and then behind the canines. And for this particular case, if you want to bring those 6 anterior teeth forward, you have premolars locked to the expander, so those premolars are not going to distalize, because for every action, there is reaction. And you have to use the implant-assisted expanders to lock those posterior teeth, not to distalize them. So this is the facial outcome. Look at the change at the level of the eyes, at the level of the cheekbones, at the level of the smile, and look at them change at the level of occlusion. We are uprighting mandibular teeth, we are protracting maxilla, and we are also bringing maxillary dentition forward into the diastema space. So this is the sagittal view. We were able to treat this patient without extractions and without maxillary advancement. So this is the change of the profile. Look at that again, relaxation of the musculature in the periorbital area as she smiles after expansion. look at the overbite, and you can see again that those lower incisors do not look proclined, and we did not extract mandibular premolars. This is occlusion before and after. And for many of these patients, once you lock those maxillary teeth to the expander, you can utilize cross-arch elastics to upright mandibular teeth. And when you upright those mandibular posterior teeth, you will make space for those low anterior teeth to be uprighted without proclining them. And after expansion, patient reports improvement in allergies, resolution of chronic headaches, resolution of chronic post-nasal drip, and resolution of snoring. When you look at the lateral sac before and after expansion, you can see significant shrinkage of the adenoidal tissue and opening of the pharyngeal space behind soft palate. You can see a change in the profile where maxilla projects more forward as compared to prior to treatment. When you look at the superimposition, you can see that we redirected mandibular growth to more vertical. We improved class 3 skeletal problem, and the lower incisor did not procline. The lower incisor actually uprighted. So this is the lower incisor, superimposition over the mandible, and you can see that we did not procline that severely crowded lower incisors. They stayed upright, and even IMPA changed from 87 to 85. And in the maxilla, we did procline slightly maxillary incisors, but maxilla also came forward. When you look at this 3D superimposition, it confirms the findings of the 2D superimposition, where we can see metafacial change where maxilla came forward and got wider. We see also changes in the nasal cavity width, and the mandible rotated down because FMA plane increased a little bit. So we were able, with the protraction face mask with class 3 mechanics, to hold mandibular forward growth and redirect it in the more vertical direction, and also bring maxilla slightly forward. And this mid-facial effect from non-surgical skeletal expansion was reported in 2018 by Dr. Moon and his group from UCLA, where we have the center of rotation at the level of the zygomaticofrontal suture. And this allows not only of expansion at the level of the mid-face, but also slight anterior repositioning of the midfacial structure. So it's very helpful for patients with class 3 malocclusion. And again, we overexpanded according to the outer and inner differential. We expanded at the level of the outer differential at the MX around 7 millimeters, and this was 63.6% of the screw expansion, and 10 millimeters of the skeletal expansion at the level of the lingual transverse maxillary mandibular relationship. So we achieved a significant skeletal expansion at the level of the MX point of 7 millimeters and 10 millimeters at the level of the palatal width of the maxilla. And we went from differential of 7 to 12 at the inner differential, and from 8 to 11 at the outer differential. So we overexpanded this patient, and in order for us to achieve good occlusion, we had to compensate with dental alveolar compensation. So maxillary teeth are going to be slightly lingually tipped in this situation, and mandibular teeth will be upright. But when you look at the minor study, they report a variation in the dental alveolar relationship with different types of maxillary widths. The wider the maxilla gets, the more lingually tipped maxillary teeth are going to be to allow good occlusion. So when you look at the outer and inner differential that are reported in the literature, the problem is that you are only looking at the transverse dimension at the level of the first molars. You are not looking at the maxilla as a whole. And many of the patients will have very minimal transverse discrepancy at the level of the posterior teeth and a significant discrepancy at the level of the anterior teeth with completely blocked out canine teeth. So you have to really look at the problem more comprehensively. So we decided to extend this project on understanding transverse relationships by looking at the pre-industrial skulls from the University of Pennsylvania Anthropology Museum, where we studied CBCTs of 50 pre-industrial skulls from Morton collection, which is a very diverse collection of human skulls. All of these skulls had 32 teeth in occlusion, had room for the wisdom teeth to be in the functional occlusion. So we look at the transverse development from the top to the bottom, from the orbital width to the mandibular width, from the front to the back of the maxilla, from the outside to the inner parameters of the maxilla and the mandible. And what we found was that there is a significant range in the maxillary mandibular differential when it comes to the outer differential, although the mean is around 5, as was reported in the Simontacci study, but the range is going from -3 to 10. So what it means, so even with the differential of -3 and the differential of +10, you still can achieve good functional occlusion because of that dentoalveolar compensation, as I was discussed earlier. But the inner differential is the same. We found that on average, the mean was between 0 to 2, but the range was 10 millimeters from -4 to +6. So even with the differential of -4, you can still achieve good occlusion. And it's because of the dentoalveolar compensation, where in the wider maxillary situation, you will have more lingual tipping of the teeth. And as maxilla gets narrower, the teeth will compensate in the maxilla by buccal tipping to allow good intercuspation. And this is what was described by Miner, three types where the maxillary mandibular teeth may be upright, as you can see in image A. And as maxilla gets narrower, you will find that the maxillary teeth are more buccally tipped, mandibular teeth more lingually tipped. And when maxilla is really wide, as we saw in many pre-industrial skulls with 32 teeth in occlusion, you will have a variation C where maxillary teeth are lingually tipped to compensate and mandibular teeth are either uprighted or slightly lingually tipped to achieve good functional intercuspation. So should we treat everyone to the average or should we apply an individualized approach to each patient? Let's talk about implant-assisted expansion. Will it allow us to avoid or minimize extraction? Will it allow us to minimize orthognathic surgery? Will it shorten treatment time? Will it allow for greater case acceptance in adults that need surgical expansion? Dr. Van Arsdell always was concerned about periodontal detrimental effect of tooth-supported expansion in skeletal immature patients. Not only you can achieve periodontal complications in adult patients utilizing tooth-supported expanders, but you can also have the same problem in adolescent patients that are skeletal immature, as you can see here in the 13-year-old female. Because as you get older, your mid-palatal suture gets more interdigitated, intertwined, and you will find that it's going to be more difficult to open it with the traditional tooth-supported expanders. A recent systematic review on different types of tooth-supported expanders supports this problem that there is bone loss on the buccal of the anchoring teeth with tooth-supported expanders. And the recommendation of that systematic review is to evaluate gingival phenotypes prior to expansion, to utilize primary dentition for anchorage during expansion. That means probably to treat in much younger age when those primary molars are still very solid and have minimal root resorption, and to utilize TAT or surgical assisted palatal expansion protocols to minimize periodontal damage. So Slick Van Arsdell was a very strong proponent of surgically assisted palatal expansion in skeletal immature patients. And it applied not only to adults, but to skeletal immature adolescent patients. So we did a lot of surgically assisted cases in at Penn during my residency for adolescent patients before we used TADS. But the literature shows that even if you utilize surgically assisted expansion. If you use two supported expanders, there is a periodontal risk with them too. And that's from a CBCT study from AGO DUA 2011. So this is my first implant-assisted expander in a periodontally compromised patient that I did with at Penn with surgically assisted protocol. This patient was not able to tolerate two supported expanders because of the periodontal involvement at the level of the molars. And in order for us to save his periodontally compromised dentition, he really needed a maxillary expansion. So we had to come up with a tooth-free expander. And this particular patient had acrylic type expander that we anchored on the four temporary implants from Rocky Mountain, RMO implants. It's called a dual top system. So you can see that we were able to achieve very nice skeletal expansion at the level of the bone. And we were able to save this patient periodontally compromised teeth. We were able to improve axial inclination of the teeth to address reverse gingival architecture due to periodontal bone loss. We were able to extrude those teeth and improve crown to root ratio. And this is what we call periodontal regeneration without periodontal surgery, with expansion. And without that implant-supported expander, we were not able to keep those posterior teeth as this patient was able to keep. So now I am following this patient for 12 years, and he still has his anterior teeth in his mouth. So when Slick was teaching expansion, we were talking about periodontal rationale for skeletal expansion. Today, we are expanding these protocols, the same protocols, the same devices, to do it in patients with compromised airway, with upper airway resistance, with nasal congestion, with any type of obstruction that will allow opening of the nasal passages. Because remember that the roof of the mouth where we are applying expansion forces is the floor of the nose. So there are going to be skeletal changes at the level of the nose after the skeletal expansion. And the first publication on the acrylic type of expander was from Brazil in 2006 by Dr. Kirstelli, where they utilized a very similar device on four implants in patients with severe form of oligodontia. And they also used protraction surgical hooks to allow maxillary protraction, and you can see a significant skeletal change for that patient. Once we started to use this device with the surgery and we saw the success, the successful retention of the expander, we started to utilize this device at Penn on adolescent patients that otherwise would need surgically assisted expansion to achieve the most optimal skeletal correction. So this was one of the publications from Penn on the twins that we utilized TED assisted expander in one twin and bonded expander in the other, and we achieved significantly more skeletal correction in the case of TED expander versus bonded expander with minimal to no tipping. So you can see minimal to no tipping with the TED assisted expander on the left versus even with bonded expander, patient presented with significant tipping of the mandibular teeth on the expander. And believe it or not, it took additional year to finish the twin that had bonded expander as compared to the twin that was finished a year earlier with the TED expander. So in that paper, Slick suggested expanded envelope of transverse correction without surgery to age 16. When I was a resident before implant-assisted expansion, the recommendation was like after the age 13, skeletal age of 12, 13, to consider surgically assisted palatal expansion. And then in 2013, if you are interested in the protocol on TED-assisted acrylic expander, I published a paper, three-dimensional control with TED tissue-supported expander, where I show two cases and I go over the protocol with two versus four implants. And one of the patients was a vertical case that we were able to treat without extraction and without intrusion of the posterior teeth, just with expansion and uprighting of the maxillary posterior teeth. And we were able to finish this case exactly in 12 months. And we also describe the 22-year-old female that we expanded with acrylic expander without surgery. In 2016, Dr. Moon with the group from Brazil published on the MSE prototype. It's a custom built MSE expander, which is like four implants placed at the level of the metapalatal suture with two bands on the molars. And today, many clinicians are using this device that came out from the Korean biomaterials. So today in my practice, I use MSE for adult patients that are going to undergo a non-surgical protocol. And my acrylic type of expander I am using for adolescent patients under the age of 16, and also adult patients that are going to go through the orthognathic surgical expansion. And again, the envelope of non-surgical correction has changed for my practice today. When in 2012, SLIC extended that to age 16. Today, in females, we have indefinite age limit for a non-surgical correction. I'm sure that some of the females still will require surgery, but at least in our practice, 90% of the adult females are treated with a non-surgical expansion protocol with MSE device. In males, it's a little bit different because of the differences in anatomy. Males that are older than 25 most likely will not respond to non-surgical expansion and will require surgical correction. So today, there is still place for the surgically assisted palatal expansion in adults. But in my practice, no one under the age of 25 today should be undergoing surgical expansion, because we have succeeded in every single patient without surgery under age 25. I think that the surgically assisted expansion is going to get less invasive, and it's already getting less invasive with the publication of DOM technique or EASE technique. We need to do more research on the surgical protocol, because the research that we have is from 30, 50 years ago. And I think this treatment will become less invasive as we do more implant-assisted expansion in adults. We also have to remember that there is a significant anatomic difference between non-surgical expansion in adults and children versus surgical expansion. With non-surgical expansion, you have a midfacial effect where the whole midfacial structure opens and changes at the level of the zygomatic bones. And with the surgical expansion, you are expanding at the level of the maxilla below maxillary zygomatic sutures because of the osteotomy cuts. And it's more like a Lefort 1 type of osteotomy. So there's going to be an anatomic difference. If the patient will require more zygomatic expansion at the level of the midfacial structures, it would be great if the age will allow for the non-surgical protocol. And this is one of my 55-year-old adult females with upper airway resistance. And you can see that without surgery with MSE expansion, we achieved significant midfacial improvement with an eye-opening effect, as I said earlier, with nicer projection of the cheekbones, fill of the buccal corridors, and the teeth in the maxilla look upright at the expansion. And the CBCT confirms midpalatal suture, parallel midpalatal suture opening from the front to the back of the jaw. So again, thank you everyone for listening, and thank you, Dr. Van Arnstel, for all your contributions and for everything you have done for our profession. We will always love you, remember you, and honor everything you have done for us. Thank you. And thank you, Miguel, again, for your beautiful presentation.